Hello, and welcome to Angela's Craft Hat. Recently, we created this bag and topper and tag at an online workshop session, and I'm now going to show you how we actually created that background using distress oxides and a plastic kind of bag or a recyclable bag that we can use with water. It used to be done with cling film, but rather than use or create extra plastic waste, we're going to use something that can be reused over and over again. As the other one showed you, you could either do your colouring on a horizontal way, like a landscape, or like this with a more random kind of application of the ink. And today, I'm going to be using three other colours of distress oxide to actually apply the ink more randomly. The size of the paper that was used against the size of the bag will be given on my blog, and the details will be shown below this video. Now, when doing the tag, which I was just showing you there, you can actually put some post-it notes on the back to prevent ink going onto the other side while we are actually inking the front, or you can then actually apply more ink once we've actually done all of the colouring that we want to do here and actually finished with the technique itself. So here you can see I'm applying the three different colours, and today I'm using mustard seed, ripe persimmon and candied apple to give some a more of a sunshiny kind of finish, if you like. And the finished one, because it has to be set aside to dry, which I'll show you in a moment, will be shown on the blog to accompany this video. You'll notice that the tag hasn't been cut at the moment, and we'll go through that later. But I tend to always colour up on a piece of card and then cut the tag afterwards. Just keep adding in small circular motions as we build up the ink. It doesn't have to be absolutely perfect for this technique, because we're actually going to be adding some water to it. So from that in the yellows and the oranges and reds, we're now going to go to where the blue and the pink one is. And this is one of the vegetable bags I was talking about. It's a composty kind of bag, and also some of the magazines come with a compost plastic covering as well. So off to the side here, I'm spritzing the bag with water, which is then going to be placed over the inks. Now, the oxides also have a double reaction to them when we add water, so we get an extra kind of effect as well. I've put the two pieces of card onto a piece of copy paper so it's easily movable out of the way, left to dry. So you move the bag around. If you think it's not got enough water on it, then you can just add a little bit. I've tried to protect the card while I've been doing this so that we don't get extra dots of oxidisation. However, you can do that. You can also apply distress ink to other silk card or coated card using a brayer and get the same kind of effects as well. Again, some samples of these will be on my blog. Whilst we leave those ones to dry, we're now going to look at stamping up the pink and the purple ones. As you can see how it has dried, we have those striations going across it, which are really good. I love how this turns out on many different ways, and it's always going to be unique. Today I'm going to be stamping with this stamp set from All and Create by Olga Hardvine, and the flowers, the large flower that we're going to see in a moment, fits really nicely down the length of the main topper. And today I'm showing some Samantha K acrylic blocks. As you can see, you get the large one, you get a more medium size, a square one, and four little ones in the pack. These are really lovely to use. They have some flexibility in them as well. Not a lot, but there is some flexibility. And then easy to actually hold and stamp with, which I'm going to show you. And details will be in the blog and in the comment there, in the details area down below. So these come from Samantha K, and the pack includes all of them in one set. Once I've decided which way I'm going to actually have the pattern, I then ink up with VersaFine Clair Nocturne ink. I'm going to put quite a bit on here so that we hold it. Now this is dry, but you do need to make sure that when you do your stamping, that your background ink has dried. This has been left overnight, so I know it's dry. Once it's inked up, then position it where you want it to be, and with some pressure, clearly not ready, and then once ready, place the stamp down and keep contact between the stamp and the paper. And leave it there so the ink really does get time to bond with your background. And there we have a nice print. When that's done, I'm then going to do the tag. As you can see, it sits, it curves around that side really. It has a little bit of a curve to it. And I think it sits really nicely with the patterns that we've got from this technique. So then I'm going to add some of the smaller flowers to the tag. I still haven't cut this. And so some of the flowers may be halved when we actually do shape the tag. And that's great. I like that idea. I like the effect of that. So again, I've inked up with VersaFine Clair Nocturne ink and keep in contact with the stamp long enough for the ink to move to settle it into the paper, so we get a really good impression. Doing the same with the little one, which I've stamped off to the edge. And then I've done a whole one, and then taking the other little stamp in this set, I'm then going to add some of the images to the top of the tag. As I said, we may lose some of these. We won't lose all of it, but we may end up with it coming off of the edge, which I always like. You don't have to have the image sitting square on the card itself. So here we have a background used in the film or the bag, the plastic bag method, stamped up, ready for colouring. Now I'm going to use my Faber-Castell Polychromos to do this, using pink and two coloured mauves. And I'm just going to add some colour to parts of the stamp using very light, either upward strokes as you see now, or round strokes. Once that was finished, I didn't want you to see all the colouring. Once that was finished, you can see here how it does pick up slightly, but I have not coloured in heavily to take away those white striations, which I really do like. Once we've done that, we're now going to emboss the edge of the topper and the tag just as it looks on the card here, on the bag. Now with the hair, I use the gold embossing, and on this one we're going to use silver. Before I do that, I do then shape the tag, and I measure it and do about a centimetre or so from the middle outwards, and then 2 centimetres down the side. So across the top it's about a centimetre, and then down the side it's about 2 centimetres. So we get our tag shape. Just erasing some of the pencil marks I didn't quite cut. So here we now have our two pieces. Making sure that there's powder on there and that everything is dry, you can use an anti-static bag, brush some talcum powder on here. This is just the same kind of thing as an anti-static bag, just in a bottle with a brush. We're then going to ink up the edges with VersaMark. And I don't do this perfectly, so you don't want a perfect line. So some areas are slightly thicker than others, as I just brush it around the edge for you. And this way we get a different kind of framing, if you like, or finishing off of the card. So it's never going to be the same. They're always going to be unique, which I kind of like, a unique finishing touch to a unique background because you can never repeat this background. You can use the same colours, but it's highly unlikely that you'll ever get the same kind of pattern. So just add in the Stampenda Silver embossing powder here. So I've used a Stampenda's fine detail one. And again on the tag. Making sure that I cover all of the Versamark ink. Any pad could be used for this that's like Versamark, so you've got Wow as well and other makes. It's a sticky ink that allows the embossing powder to stay in place as you heat it. Just give it a quick wipe there. Now if you've got a small piece or even a large piece, sometimes it might be easier to hold with a peg or another piece of a tool or any other kind of equipment. As you see, I always heat the embossing powder from underneath and occasionally going to the top. I know you can heat from the top as well. It's entirely up to you. It's your own preference. I was taught embossing to heat from underneath, and wherever I can, I do that. If we're going on to a thicker substrate like MDF or anything, then I'll go from the top. But on card, I tend to always go from the bottom and then heat over the top to make sure that it has all melted. When you are embossing, either from above or from below, keep the heat gun steady, although you don't want to burn the card. So you need to be mindful of that. You don't want to get too close. But if you waft it too much, then it takes quite a while for the powder to actually get the heat and start to melt. Be careful of overheating, as too much heat will cause the embossing powder to then actually seep into the card itself. I'm just finishing the edges here. And you can see how uneven it is from that shot, which I like. I didn't want it perfect. If you wanted it a perfect finish, you may want to consider using it's a double-sided tape that will hold the embossing powder, though you've got to be careful that the tape doesn't melt as well. Or you might want to be particularly more precise as to how you actually apply the ink. But I'm happy with the randomness of the way the embossing powder has actually gone on. Once that was done, there was one final thing that was done to the topper and the tag, and that was to add some glitter. And to do this, I'm using a quickie glue pen around mainly the centres of the flowers on this. So it was done around the centres of the flower just to give it a little bit of extra zoosh, if you like. It's not necessary to do this. I didn't do it on the hair. So on the first one we saw, I did not put any glitter in. But we could do this. You can add sequins as well to this, which on the finished product, I actually do. I don't do it on this video, but it is done. You will see them on the finished photo, which is on the blog. And how to make the bag is a separate video. So once all this is glued up, I'm going to add some glitter. This is Pergamano glitter from the Clarity stamp. It comes in a number of different hints of colour. So there's blue, pink, yellow, green, gold and silver. And I've actually used the pink on this one. It's not that easy to see the colour, the light catching the actual pink, but you can see that the glitter is on, is there. And in real life, it does have a pink tone to it. Just making sure everything's all tidied up here and cleared up. And then this is the finished articles ready to go on the bag, which is on another video. Thank you for watching. I hope you enjoy trying this technique